Good afternoon. I'd just like to start with two short comments. First of all, I'd like to thank Dublin Civic Trust and Graham and Geraldine in particular. I find them a source of constant inspiration and comfort when we're dealing with issues in relation to the promotion and protection of Dublin's built and architectural heritage. They really are a solace during some dark and dismal days when you're looking for a bit of a lift. You ring Geraldine and you always come away, and Graham, you always come away buoyed and inspired by their vision and their passion. So thank you, and this is a real manifestation of what you've done today. So thank you to you both. It's been wonderful, really superb. Secondly, unlike many of your previous speakers, I'm not an architect and I'm not a planner, so I'm afraid my presentation is more words than images. So apologies in advance for that. I have an office in Mountjoy Square. That's it through the trees. It's not an image that you'd see often of the square. It's taken, I think, from Mary's house. I'm not quite sure who took it. I suspect the photographer is here. But it's, it shows Mountjoy Square for what it is at present from a particular vantage. We've heard a lot about the square. Karen gave a very interesting and entertaining introduction to the square. As everybody now knows, there's about 1,500 people living on the square. It is Dublin's only Georgian square, I'm advised, in terms of the dimensions of the square. It's a key part of the North Georgian core. And of course, it has strong cultural and historical links. As we enter into the decade of centenaries, very few people know that the first Doyle met in Mountjoy Square. The buildings are a key part of the character and formation of Ireland over the last 200 years. And sadly, that's an element to Mountjoy Square that isn't much recognised and much celebrated. If you see some poor Italian tourists wandering around the square, they won't know which buildings are associated with who, but that's hopefully something that we'll be able to address. We also have a really strong community. There's a really strong, vibrant community. It's a very mixed community. 54% of people living on the square were born outside Ireland. We've families back in the square. It's diverse, it's dynamic, and it's an engaging place to be during day and at night. The houses themselves, I mean, it was sad to hear Karen say that seven of the houses were destroyed from the 1980s, as recently as the 1980s. But while we bemoan what's gone, there's a lot left. The 43 of the 67 houses are there. And when you saw some of the interiors, and hopefully tomorrow you'll all come up to Mountjoy Square on your tour of the squares and see what we have up there, it really is special and worth preserving, worth protecting, and worth celebrating. The society was founded by Ruan McKeown a number of years ago. We incorporated the society into a company limited by guarantee about 4 years ago, and the aims of the society were to promote Mountjoy Square and to make it a better place to live, work and visit. It's representative of residents, businesses and owners. The square in 2013, we've heard some negative, but there's a lot of positive about the square, and I'm going to try and give you a balance. I'm, of course, biased because I'm a passionate advocate for the square. I spend most of my working life up in the square. I mean, there are huge improvements in the square. It's complete again. The gaps are gone in the building, and I'll show you a picture that indicates what it was like during the worst of the days in the 80s. There is a major and diverse residential makeup in the square. I think if you calculate, there's something about 54 different nationalities living around the square. There are diverse employment purposes. We've got colleges, we've got other educational, we've got solicitors, doctors, but it's mainly residential. I think there's probably only about two buildings in the square that don't have a residential element, and that's fantastic. There's been a big private sector investment in regeneration, and there are some individuals like Karen, who's been a stalwart, and I see Mary Laheen here, and of course the McCones, who really played a huge part in the preservation of particularly the east side of the square. Without those people's investment and commitment in the square, it wouldn't be what it is today. You wouldn't be looking at 43 surviving buildings, you'd be looking at a lot less. There are some negative things. There are inadequate visitor attractions, and that's something we'll come and talk to you about, Aidan. We're a resilient a bunch. There's a perception, and it is a perception largely, of security concerns and safety concerns. Elements of the public realm are poor and need to be improved. There is poor rented housing stock. We have a unique phenomenon in Mountjoy Square. If anybody goes up and they look at the first floor buildings and some of them, they'll see that some landlords have subdivided the first floor rooms into two separate apartments, which breaches every housing bylaw that must exist or any building regs that must exist. And they're squashing people into accommodation there, which they shouldn't be doing. And then most recently, the course of the decline, we've seen vacancy and vulnerable buildings emerging. So that's of huge concern to us. Here's an aerial shot of the square in 1992. And I think you can see the improvement. So there's a gap in the building line there. Here there's a gap in the building line, and here, and on the corner here. Okay, what's replaced them is pastiche. But Karen was saying that previously Mountjoy Square used to be used as a film set for war movies, London, wartime London, bombed out buildings, are we're still used for movie sets. We've gone up a little bit. We're now used for sets about gangs like Love, Hate, and we're sort of hoping someone will do a rom-com there. And of course, maybe one of Cecilia Hearn's books or something like that. You know, it's a good location. Here's Mountjoy Square as it is today. You've seen this picture before from people. Again, it's the facade is back, the integrity is restored. The park is, of course, what stands out at you in terms of an element of the public realm, and we're making huge progress on that, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Creating a context for regeneration. One of the things that happened, one of the very positive things that happened in the square over the last number of years has been the designation of Mountjoy Square and its environs as an ACA, an architectural conservation area. That happened in May 2011. And it has really been significant as a context. It's not a solution for all of our challenges, but it gives a very strong context rooted in the architectural heritage of the area and has been extremely helpful in terms of communicating our requirements and our needs with statutory agencies, with authorities, and with the external audiences. We've got rid of the commuter coaches. And just to clarify one thing, they didn't go to Merrion Square. They actually went to North Wall Quay and to North Wapping Street, where there are no residential areas. But to understand the significance of the removal of the coaches for us, every day they were there, parked there, engines humming, contributing nothing to the square, not bringing anybody to the square. They were dropping people on Parnell Square and then coming and resting over. They contributed nothing to it. They took away from it. And it was a nuisance. It was a real fillip for us as a group when those coaches moved, because it showed people that we could achieve things. We could get movement in an area where there was a level of intractability up to then. There is an initiative on the park underway, which Les Moore talked about, and that's a really encouraging. We got the Mountjoy Square Society got funding from the Irish Public Bodies Mutual Corporate Social Responsibility Fund to make our contribution to that study, and we're really that's very exciting for us. There's a strong community organisation in place. There is limited investment, and we have an increased public interest in the area. What's needed for renewal? A lot of people talking today have spoken about the need for vision, the need for a plan, the need for coordination between and within agencies. And I'm sure people from Dublin City Council will forgive me if I say the amount of times I've been to meetings in the council with people and 5 minutes into the meeting somebody says, "Where's roads and traffic?" You know, there are oftentimes people within our sections, within organisations, or whether it's central government or local government, the structures don't work together. Thankfully, the ACA has changed that from our perspective because it does give the context within which we interact with local government. Incentivisation is required. I mean, we talked about the wealth going to the Southern Core, the Southern Georgian Core. You know, wealth isn't going to come to the North Georgian Core, and we'll look at why in a minute. And you're also, to have renewal, you're also going to need some brave and foolhardy people with access to money. In terms of incentivising, you know, I'm firmly of the view that for the North Georgian Core, for the area up around here, up around Mountjoy Square, the market is not going to bring about renewal without some sort of assistance. Investment up in Mountjoy Square or around here, it's not for the meek. And while we have seen significant investment in public housing stock and much needed investment, there has been very little investment in the existing Georgian housing stock. There are new opportunities that are there at present. We have a number of properties for sale on Mountjoy Square, which are on the market by receivers. NAMA is meant to be doing something, I'm not quite sure what, in relation to historic properties. And then there are pre-63 units that are going to come on the market, or increasingly coming on the market. But one of the problems that we have is that the lack of incentives leads to lack of investment, or it leads to that investment going elsewhere where people can get a better return or better yield. Or what you get is the wrong sort of investment, where people will sweat the building and they'll compromise the fabric and but what's important, what's distinctive about the building to make more money. They won't give a damn about the protected status of it. And we've seen that, again, Karen showed some photos of it. Or you'll have, sadly, dereliction, decay and decline. Now, these are pictures taken in 2013. The one on the left is a slightly squashed photo of number 15 Mountjoy Square. Since that picture was taken, the door has gone in. That's a real worry. We have 43 houses left. Let's make sure it's not 42. The picture in the middle is Gardiner Place, and the one on the right is North Frederick Street. So these are real properties at risk close to this area and close to the North Georgian Core that we're all focused on today. What do we need to do to incentivise investment? We saw a lot of what was wrong with some of the regeneration and renewal programmes from the 80s and the 90s, but I think there are certain core principles that we've learned from that we can embrace. So it should be aimed at vulnerable housing stock, focused on areas of economic deprivation, prioritise towards owner-occupiers, facilitate the creation of living and diverse communities. That's a key to it, diverse communities. We have a mixture of people living and existing in an area. Provision of good quality housing, not the sort of shoeboxes that Karen was talking about earlier. Rooted in good conservation practice and absolutely cognizant of modern living requirements. The house that I operate out of in Mentor Square is 6,000 square feet. Who's going to move a single family in there? There are very few people who can, so there may be some compromises required in terms of what's available and what's possible. The Living Cities Initiative that the Minister spoke about today is a positive development, and I think it came as a surprise to most people. It is piloted in Waterford and Limerick, and it's focused very much on Georgian buildings in deprived areas. I don't mean to be trite when I say this, but it is well-intentioned, and I think the aims that it sets out to achieve are positive. It's a tax-based incentive, so you get tax relief for substantial work. It's available to you on the rate of 10% per year over 10 years. The reliefs are lost if it ceases to be your principal private residence, and the reliefs are not transferable to a new owner. There are also benefits for retailers in areas. There are limitations with the scheme. First of all, there are size limitations. So the relief only applies on houses with a total floor area of greater than 210 metres. So, for example, the house I'm in is 580 square metres. It seems a bit perverse that the larger houses, which are likely to need more rent, more investment, won't benefit from the scheme. It's also a pilot scheme. It's unclear some elements as to how it's applied. So if you get a house and you subdivide it for other occupants, what's the extent of the relief that you're going to get? And of course, it's also only confined to Limerick and Waterford. This is a graph that the government published when they were talking about the justification for the scheme. And they talked about deprivation, saying Limerick was -7.42 and Waterford -4.69 in the deprivation index, as against Dublin -1.11. We interposed Dublin City, Mountjoy B and Rotunda A just to show that the Dublin figures isn't necessarily representative for this area. And you look at the change in population between 2006 and 2011 for this area, a 20% decrease in population. You have an unemployment rate of 36%. For the Rotunda A, you have an unemployment rate of 25.9%. Okay, the employment is staple there. Graham, we're not looking for accolades, and we're certainly not looking for this accolade, but Graham described this area as the premier deprived Georgian area in the state. Not an accolade we're proud of, but it certainly is an accolade that should encourage the government to extend the Living Cities Initiative into this area, because I'd be afraid that unless they do, there isn't going to be the demand for it in the areas in Waterford and Limerick. It is absolutely right that it should be there, but this is where it's needed as well. There is a demand for housing. There is Georgian housing stock that needs to be renovated, and there is also extensive deprivation. The government, we met with the Minister for Finance's advisors and some of his officials, and they said, well, the reason they couldn't extend the Living City Initiative to Dublin City was because it's a capital city and there might be state aid concerns. I just don't understand the logic behind that. It fits the criteria or it doesn't, and I'd be a bit concerned that that's been used as a block on something that should happen. There are other incentives. I think the Civic Trust has shown the benefits of the Building Conservation Revolving Fund. I think that needs to be revisited. Philanthropy, targeted conservation projects, absolutely. Tax relief for income earned from property. Some people in the area have been doing Airbnb, which has been a really great boost, bringing visitors up to the area, earning income in a sustainable and responsible way out of the properties. There are other reliefs that can be delivered locally. Rates, municipal charge breaks. Somebody talked about the Lewis levy. There is a case, certainly, for anybody who's taking on a major project involving a Georgian building to have that waived. Make it attractive for people to invest in the city, and let some opportunities to impose charges pass. If I want to do my windows in Mountjoy Square, to paint them or clean them, I have to spend €250 for a cherry picker for a day. Okay, fair enough, there's a loss for parking space, but there's a contribution you're making by doing that. Look at things like that. And I suppose to work with conscientious owners who want to do the right thing, we would get a sense sometimes that there are flagrant breaches of the planning law, and the people who are doing them seem to just, throw two fingers to the city council. You'd almost be saying, given the nature of the crime that they're involved in and the damage they're doing, it's almost a case of putting cab on people like them. It's unacceptable that they feel they can get away with it and that they can outsmart and outwit and outresource the local authority that is strained in its capacity to tackle flagrant breaches by persistent offenders. There is much to preserve and protect. There is much to be optimistic and positive about. There is a lot of things that we've lost, but we've learned from that, and let's hope we can implement what we've learned. We do need a plan. I think that's one of the things that's absolutely critical. It must be a plan to underpin regeneration and investment. The efforts of enthusiasts won't be sufficient. It's going to need people coming in with cash, incentivized to come in cash, to invest their cash responsibly and in a way that respects the building and the building fabric that they're involved in, and creating diverse and living communities. The state needs to step up to the plate, and I would hope we could take some encouragement from the Minister's comments this morning when he talked about the state having a role, that it's not just an issue for central government. Let's hope that we can hold him to that. Thanks very much.